want pizza.
Hey, I'm Aaron.
And I'm John.
And this is Pastors and Pizza,
a podcast where two normal pastors,
or abnormal,
consume some of the best
and worst
pizzas that the area has to offer,
while trying to make sense of our faith and figure out how it connects with the world around us.
We believe that the best conversations happen over food.
So if you're hungry for spiritual nourishment,
craving some honest conversations,
and always up for a good slice,
pull up a chair, grab a slice,
pour a cold one, unless you're driving, of course,
and get ready to savor the flavors of faith,
chew on some thought-provoking discussions,
and satisfy your craving for both pizza and a deeper connection with God.
On Pastors and Pizza. Welcome back, friends.
How y'all doing? Hopefully you said good. Aaron, how are you doing?
I'm well. I noticed how you paused after you asked that question, which was
nice. I was waiting for the response.
Waiting for a response. Yeah. I'm well. How about you today, Joe?
I'm doing pretty good. Sun's out.
Guns out.
Guns aren't out. I've got those undercover.
Yeah. Well,
like so undercover that not sure they're there.
Mine are under layers and not just clothes, but whatever. We'll talk about
that. Yeah, that's not the point of this podcast. So let's go ahead and move on.
All right.
So it's been a little while. We have finally made it to a new pizza place. Aaron, yeah. Where did we go today?
Not Bravo's, Brava's.
Brava. Oh, Brava. Wait.
Yeah, see, it sounds weird, but it's the effeminate version of Bravo in Snohomish. And what was in that building before, John? Do you remember?
I have no idea.
I don't
know. Was there something in that building before?
There was. I can't remember what it is, but you guys... Pretty good pizza, actually.
Yeah, so Brava Pizza in Snohomish. So I'm going to be honest with you guys. We're in a bit of a conundrum here because it takes quite a while to get to the places we maybe want to go.
Mm-hmm.
And we don't necessarily have the time to devote to travel, ordering, eating, and then also discussing everything. And so... We did go to Snohomish, which is not exactly close, but it's not far away.
No, and no offense to Brava, because it sounds like we settled on them.
I mean, we did.
Oh.
When we were making the decision.
Yeah.
So,
okay.
Yeah. So, yeah, we wanted to go somewhere maybe a little bit more unknown, a little bit more creative, but... Like I said, those are places that are a little further away and little harder for us to do during the week. So we're gonna have to figure out a way to maybe do some of that.
We are. Any suggestions, you guys, let us know.
Yeah. Thanks. So we did choose Brava Pizza in Snohomish, and I will say that I wasn't expecting a lot, and it was pretty good.
Which is a discussion in and of itself. If you lower your expectations, you're far happier, apparently.
Well, yeah, and we've had this conversation before. I try to go into things with a little bit lower expectations, so then I'm pleasantly surprised rather than disappointed.
Indeed.
Yeah.
I mean, that's
so this is legitimately probably one of those cases where I didn't expect a lot. But that said, the pizza actually was pretty good.
I liked it. I was second bite in. I enjoyed some new elements that were already there, but I tasted them anew. So what was on our pizza? What pizza did we get?
Yeah, so we got something called the Mikey. And I don't know why it's called the Mikey. It's Mikey is in quotations on their menu. I don't know if Mikey's the owner or kid that just belongs to them. I don't know.
But maybe it's a woman named Michelle that they call Mikey, and there's the quotations. So it's
quote unquote Mikey.
There you go. I don't know.
I just think if you're you know 40 or older, maybe probably 45 or older, you know the old Life commercials. Mikey likes it.
Ooh,
that's what I think of. But so the Mikey. And it says in parentheses here on the menu that they recommend the thin crust. So one of the things that's kind of cool about Brava, at least in theory, because we only tried this one pizza, but they have several crust options that seem to be available on just about any pizza you want. There's some exceptions or some size issues with some of the crust types. But they do have a hand-tossed crust, a thin crust, a thick crust, which... I'm guessing that's like a pan pizza, but we didn't get that. So I don't totally know.
No, that's real.
They also have a gluten-free crust and then stuffed crust. So.
And we were close to getting.
Aaron threw out the possibility of the stuffed crust.
But I like the thin as well.
We got the thin because that's what was recommended. I will say for some of you, I know that the gluten-free options are not always readily available for people.
Right.
So the fact that they have gluten-free could be very nice for some of you guys. It is only available in the 12-inch size, and it's an extra $6.
Yikes.
So one thing we'll get into here is their pizzas are already kind of expensive.
They are.
So like the Mikey, for instance, for a 12-inch pizza, $25.99. So if you add $6 to that to get the gluten-free crust, yikes.
And really, it's probably because it had so much basil and they had to hand grow and pay people to...
Can you hand grow something?
You know, you can
harvest. Do you pull the leaves out of the seed? How does that work?
Poor choice. And we've talked about you can't make things grow sometimes. Yeah. So yeah, no hand growing, but hand harvesting.
All right. So it is a bit pricey there. I will say if you go Monday through Friday between 11 and 3, which we did, you get 25% off.
Ta-da.
So that was good. We did not know that going in. That was a pleasant surprise. So the Mikey had pepperoni, it had bacon, it had green peppers, red onion, feta, fresh basil, and uncooked tomato.
There it is.
Any thoughts on that assortment?
Yeah, I mean, in retrospect, there was a lot of veggies on it. It almost looked like a salad when it came to us with all of the basil in it. I actually liked the taste of basil, so that was fine, but it was almost a little too much. And then the tomatoes, almost, again, a little too much. I liked it, though. It kind of had a fresh, and then that bacon in there, that came in and surprised. But I think overall, I was happy with all those. There's a lot of onions, too. But really, I think probably a little too much basil, a little too much on the tomato. I might even have it without the tomato next time.
Yeah, I think I would generally agree. I think while the combination was good, it was heavy on the basil and the tomato, and so those kind of overwhelmed the other tastes or those other flavors. I didn't honestly notice much onion on mine. The feta was pretty light. Green pepper was light.
I like the chunks. They had chunks of feta though, and they got crisped. So that part I was happy about. Yeah. But there wasn't a ton of it.
And then the thin crust was pretty good crust, kind of crispy. Honestly, it was probably a little weak for the amount of toppings that were on there, though. It was kind of
flimsy
a little bit. So
it was nice and crispy on the outside.
Yeah. That was Brava Pizza. We don't necessarily need to belabor it. I will say that if you're familiar here locally with Alfie's. The interior vibe of Brava gives kind of an Alfie's feel, which is not necessarily a compliment.
And the flooring was nicer. That's kind of have this parquet.
Yeah, I mean, it wasn't like a total knockoff. It just kind of felt like an Alfie's. Yeah. It did have a separate bar section with what looked to be a decent tap list. So that's, you know, somewhat intriguing if you're going to go on a Friday night or something. So
indeed. So yeah. Same, though. I mean, generally... good experience. There was a bunch of people in there with their kids, which didn't bug me, but you know, the lady kept apologizing. I like that they would open up their place to look like a birthday party almost, which is kind of a weird thing on a Wednesday, but whatever. They like people apparently over there at Brava, and that makes me happy.
Yeah. So yeah, it was a good experience. Not too far away. Pizza was good. Little on the pricey side. We got a 12-inch Mikey. I know I could have eaten the entire thing if I wanted to. You probably could have too. We didn't do that. We shared two thirds of it, and then we brought home another part of it. So roughly. And we didn't bring it home. We brought it to the office,
and that it got gobbled up, which is great. That's why we brought it.
Yeah. So if you really were super hungry, I don't know if I'd suggest Brava because it's too expensive to. Satisfy true hunger.
And some of you are they have less appetites than us and they have greater budgets, so whatever.
But well, that's our suggestion. And if we had gotten a different crust option, it maybe would have been more filling too. So
that's true.
So last episode, Aaron, we talked about maybe putting out kind of our top five or so pizza places, right? So we've done several places now over the 3 or so years that we've been doing this. Let me just run very quickly through. I left off all of the frozen pizza stuff because we weren't going to consider that for this.
Tells you what we think about that.
So here's our pizzas in order from episode 1 through our last episode. Sahara, Rico's, Jet City, Donato's, a.k.a. Red Robin, Domino's, Pizza Hut, Little Caesars. Those are technically all at one time. Gino's, District Brewing, Coconut Kenny's, Papa Murphy's, Monroe Pizza and Pints, Cat House Pizza, Good Brewing, Modo, Alfie's, Toscano's, Mod, Godfather's, Costco, Heritage Pizza, our only out-of-state option down in the Colony, Texas, Red Pepper, Trails End, and 7-Eleven. And now Brava.
Nice.
So, top five. Not necessarily in order. Just give me your top five.
Not necessarily in order. I will go with District, Coconut Kenny's, Monroe Pizza and Pints, Modo, and Heritage. Out of state for my final one there, but not my fifth necessarily.
All right. So I don't know if this is an indicator that it's clear cut or if it's an indicator that we're just very similar. But we've got almost the exact same list. So I will say, I'm going to try and do this in order, actually. Modo Pizza.
Mm-hmm. That's my number one.
Too. District Brewing. I think I'm going to then go Coconut Kenny's.
Okay.
Then I'm probably going to go Heritage and then Jet City.
Nice. So Jet City and Geno's.
Subject to change.
I mean, not Jet City and Geno's. Jet City and Heritage. Wait, no. Which one
did you have? So I had Jet City and you did not.
Oh, I had Monroe.
And you
had
Monroe Pizza and Pints and I did not.
There you go.
So that's roughly our top five. For those of you who are really interested in the pizza aspect of the show, there you go. Those are the ones to hit.
If
you haven't hit those ones, we recommend that. Like I said, we are going to try and figure out a way to get to maybe more exotic locations in the future. And see, I found a list here recently of the pizza trends for 2024 that I was going to maybe share. But since we did the top places, we'll put that one off. But a lot of the trends that you're seeing aren't necessarily haven't made it to some of the more local establishments. Oh. They're a little bit more of the foodie kind of places that you have to hit, you know, maybe Seattle or Bellevue or whatever. So
that'll be great.
So that is it. Anything else for you on the pizza talk here, Aaron?
You know what? Anytime you can talk about pizza, it's a good day.
All right. Yeah. I like talking about pizza and I like eating it even more.
Yes, sir.
So, all right. We will be back in a minute on Pastors and Pizza.
Bye-bye.
Okay, we're back on Pastors and Pizza. We hope you enjoyed that musical interlude.
I hope you missed us as well. We sure missed you.
Yes, we didn't know what to do with ourselves for these 30 seconds.
That's mostly true.
Okay. Yeah. So Aaron, it's been, you know, a little while since we last got together for this this little thing here. What's been happening?
Gosh, I don't know that I mentioned, did we talk about all of my grandchildren that were born?
We have talked about your most recent additions, both of them.
Can you tell how very excited I am about
that? Aaron doesn't like to talk about his grandkids, you guys.
Oh, I love them all. I love their parents as well. So the big thing that's been happening for me is that high school baseball started back up.
Are you in high school?
You know, I'm good height for an eighth grader. But no, I'm not in high school.
Oh, okay.
But I help coach high school baseball.
Got it. That's where this ties in. Got it. Okay.
I'm an assistant coach. I coach the JV and then help assist with the varsity. And it's been wonderful. Good conversations. Great opportunity to meet some new kids, new families. We're actually seeing the parents of the kids. Now, we've had little pockets of that step up and help out with the field and concessions and all that. But man, John, we're just seeing a real groundswell of community there, and it's been pretty cool. How about you? What's been going on with you?
Cool. Yeah, not a ton going on. As you guys are aware, my daughter Abby is getting married in May, and so we've had some busyness going on with that. We did a walkthrough kind of test drive of our catering option to just make sure it was going to work out okay. So we got that squared away. Abby had her first, I didn't go to this, but Abby had her first wedding shower a few days ago. So she got lots of cool gifts and has some better stuff than we have. So, you know, that's how it goes.
It's supposed to go that way.
I feel, someone was saying to my wife that they feel like, you know, after about 20 years of marriage, you should do like another wedding registry so you can kind of update your stuff. And I was like, that's the great idea. It wasn't her idea. Someone suggested it to her, but yeah, I think it's a good idea. So I'm going to go ahead and I'm going to be registered, you guys, at Nordstrom. So feel free to look that up and,
Nordstrom. Wow.
Send some gifts my way.
Next level.
Yeah. I mean, if you're going to do it, you might as well,
go for it. I guess so.
See what happens. So that's kind of it. We're playing a little bit of pickleball. Went up to that place Volley up in Marysville again with Abby and her fiance and my wife Christina, and we played a little nice pickleball and we had men's retreat this past weekend.
Both of us enjoyed men's retreat. So that was a little bit of pickleball.
Played a little pickleball there. Yeah, so getting after it on the pickleball, and hoping for better weather to keep that going. But one thing that I've been thinking about here this week is we just had the Oscars. We didn't, but I mean the Oscars were held a few days ago.
Really, we're done early in the afternoon / evening.
Yeah, that. I mean, I was looking on my guide on my TV streaming, and it said it was going to be over at like 8:00 or something like that. And so I was like, oh yeah, it's on tonight. So I flipped over to it, and he's like, all right, and that's it for this year's Oscars. And it was like 7:35 or something. I'm like, oh, all right.
Wow.
Dang, they finished early this year.
Yeah, which doesn't hurt my feelings.
It's probably because they just gave all the awards to Oppenheimer, and then kind of moved on.
I haven't even seen that movie.
Yeah. So let's talk about that a little bit. All so right. You guys probably know that I have this thing called the AMC Stubbs A-List, which means that I can go to 3 movies a week, any format, all for like $22 a month.
See, and friends, I just want to point out, though John is a stud, it's not studs, it's stubs.
Stubs.
Okay, there you go.
It is the A-List, though. I am on the A-List.
Of course you are.
So,
you paid for it, but yeah.
I mean, it's like, I don't know if you guys, your kids have ever gotten the stuff in the mail when they're in high school. You've been selected for the national honor, whatever, or sometimes athletically, like you're an all-star and
All-American.
All you got to do is send a $79.95 and then you get to be like, wait a second, was I chosen for this or am I just buying it?
No. Right.
Anyway, I digress. But it got me thinking, because I have the AMC Stubbs A-List, and previously I had the Movie Pass, right? So I did a little research on how many movies I went to see in the theater in 2023.
Wow.
It's 30.
You saw 30?
I saw 30 movies in the theater in 2023.
Well done.
Yeah.
I mean, that's pretty impressive. And I don't know, borderline, is there an intervention in your future?
Well, so here's my thinking. I'm paying for up to 3 a week.
That's okay.
There's 52 weeks in a year.
That's what I heard.
I didn't even see one a week.
That's right. And I didn't even do good math, and I realized that's 150 plus movies.
Look at you. See? You're getting it. See, so I've got some room for improvement, I think, here. We'll see what 2024 has in store. I will tell you that I am not on the pace. I'm probably behind last year's pace, actually.
Friends, no intervention needed, apparently.
So, interestingly enough, of the Best Picture nominees for the Oscars, I saw one of them in the theater.
Oh, all right.
I saw Killers of the Flower Moon in the theater. I have since seen only 2 of the other movies, but at home.
Right.
So I'm not on the Academy board here choosing these things, clearly.
No.
Because I would put the 3 that I saw, but not at the theater, Oppenheimer, The Holdovers at home, and then Killers of the Flower Moon in the theater. So those are three Oscar contenders that I've seen.
Okay.
I didn't particularly like Oppenheimer or Killers of the Flower Moon. The Holdovers, I thought, was actually a decent movie. That was decent.
I've not seen any of these, by the way.
Yeah. Friends. So I'm gonna tell you about a resource that I've been using that allowed me to see Oppenheimer, because one of the biggest reason I did not see it in the theater is because there's like sex scenes throughout the middle of the movie, and I'm like, yeah, I'm not gonna go see that. But I'm gonna tell you about a resource. So, so it got me thinking of the 30 movies that I saw in the theater. What are my Oscar contenders?
Yeah, you're gonna. This is all right? You, man. Get it.
And so I tried to rank the top 10. And what I established while doing this is that most of the movies that I went and saw this past year were just all right, which fits, if you know me, that's what everything is anyway. But it was very hard to differentiate most of the movies. Are they top 10? Are they bottom 10? Middle 10? I don't know. They're all about the same.
Middleton.
So this is my very loose ranking of my top 10.
All right, let's get it.
Okay, so Boys in the Boat.
Mm-hmm.
Mission Impossible, The Day of Reckoning, Part 1.
Oh.
Or, sorry, Dead Reckoning. I don't even know what it's called. Dead Reckoning, Part 1.
So wait, are we going top to bottom on this?
This is top 10 in order from 1 to 10.
All right, sorry.
Creed 3.
Mm-hmm.
Gran Turismo.
Mm-hmm.
Indiana Jones and the Dial of Destiny.
Okay.
Air.
Hmm.
Guardians of the Galaxy Volume 3.
Wow.
Godzilla Minus 1.
Okay.
The Hunger Games, The Ballad of Songbirds. And Super Mario Bros.
Wow.
So there you go.
I've got some to aim for there, because I haven't seen all of those.
That's my top 10. And nice. It's very, yeah, very loose, because like I said, there's a lot of movies you could interchange there.
Yeah, for sure.
Yeah. So
sounds like me, honestly, a little bit with our top 5 pizza places, but whatever.
Yeah, I mean, I would agree. There's a little bit of a very, very fine line between some of these things. Indeed. So that's my my John Merwin at the Oscars for
you. Thank you, John.
Yeah. If I remember which of our buttons was the applause one, I would do it, but I don't remember which one.
Sorry, that's
one
right. It is. Well, so we could do that in post-production.
So Aaron, we've been trying to share some helpful resources here on the show.
Yeah.
I don't know how helpful it's been. I haven't really heard any feedback on it.
Me either. Frankly, John, as we were talking, I'm wondering, and this is on air, you can edit it out if you'd like, is this even helpful at all? The podcast itself.
Wow.
We've heard from some people.
Do we want to go? I don't know if my ego can take that discussion.
Well, I guess maybe I get so many people letting me know what's helpful and not helpful.
Oh.
That this one for me is like, okay, I enjoy it. It's helpful for me. I got one friend, and I won't say his name, but his Eminem is like an actual like description of his name. He says that it's helpful, and he enjoys it, and he gives good feedback, and so does another guy. But, you know, I just want to know. So you guys let us know, and if you like it, tell people about it. But
yeah,
to that end, Give us a resource that would be helpful.
All right, so I'm gonna continue the movie theme with my resource. Nice. So I have recently started. I think I might have mentioned it on the last episode, but I don't think I'd really started using it yet. So I've been using a resource called VidAngel recently,
mm-hmm.
And what that is, it's basically a filtering service for your streaming. Okay, so you connect whatever streaming accounts that you have, whether it's Netflix, Prime, Disney Plus, Apple, Hulu, Peacock, mm-hmm. Max, all of those are included. There might be some more that are also part of it. Now, you do have to have a subscription to each of those things.
Yeah. Oh, for sure.
So, I mean, it's not getting you subscribed to those, right? But you can connect your streaming services to VidAngel.
Nice.
And then you set kind of these blanket filters, and so it will filter according to whatever you set. So for violence, for language, for sex or nudity or just intimacy type stuff, gore, all that kind of stuff. Oh, nice. Can be filtered out, and it does a pretty good job. Now, obviously, depending on how much of that content is in the movie, especially like the visual things,
right?
You know, whether it's sex or violence or whatever, if it's a good chunk of the movie, then it, you know, it feels a little herky jerky, like it's skipping, because it is.
Which you might want to, you know, pay attention to what you're watching.
Yeah. And then language, anything audio, it just mutes it, right? Nice. So you're not hearing it. If you read lips, you will be able to potentially still see what they're saying. But all right. It mutes it. So it's maybe a little less herky-jerky and distracting. Mm-hmm. But the point is, it allows you to maybe watch some things that you wouldn't otherwise consider. Or maybe you would consider and maybe shouldn't consider.
Outstanding.
And so it helps. And so, yeah. So I think it's been a very helpful tool. It's $9.99 a month. Mm-hmm. So it is an extra subscription. So that kind of sucks. If you're super into the techie side of things, like you really want 4K on that kind of stuff, unfortunately it doesn't show it in 4K. So even if it's on, say, Prime in 4K, if you're watching it on VidAngel, it won't be in 4K.
Okay.
So that's unfortunate. I'd like to see things. I've got a 4K TV. I want to see things in 4K, but mm-hmm. I'd rather, you know, see it than not see it, because I'm not going to watch it otherwise. On a lot of these things.
Which is why, for instance, you could watch Oppenheimer.
Yeah, so for instance, that's kind of actually the main reason. So it's like, man, everyone says Oppenheimer is really good. It seems like it might be a good movie from the story, and I wanted to see it, but I was like, I'm not gonna see it with this the stuff in the middle like that, right? And so I was like, well, maybe I'll try out VidAngel, and then I can watch Oppenheimer.
Mm-hmm.
I watched it, and then it's like, it wasn't really that great of a movie, in my opinion, but whatever.
Oh boy.
So that's my resource. I love it. Like I said, $9.99 a month.
Gosh, you got me intrigued, man.
It gives you, like I said, an opportunity just to watch a bunch of stuff that maybe is decent stuff, if not for some of the crap that's in it. And so you're able to.
Please don't say crap out of
it. I'm sorry. We need vid, we need audio angel for our podcast to filter my language.
I believe the Holy Spirit resides inside your heart, friend.
I apologize.
Okay, thanks.
Aaron?
Yes, sir.
Do you have a resource you'd like to share?
I believe I've shared this one before, but recently it's been helpful from a financial standpoint and from just a bevy of book options. Christian Book Distributors, but it's christianbook.com. If you order from there, you get a lot of different offers if you allow them to do that, email or texting. And they let you know about new stuff coming out, great prices on things, super great prices.
They'll even send you old school catalogs.
That's right. In the mail.
In the mail.
Look, I got mail, right? And like real mail. But yeah, I just really enjoy that resource. There's a lot of even older books that are really pretty significantly cheap. And so recently I got some stuff from Preston Sprinkle, some of his newer things, and really reasonably priced. I'm not saying you should avoid people's websites or whatever, but rarely will they give you a better deal than Christian Book Distributors.
Now, here's a question. I mean, I've used Christian Book quite a bit over mm-hmm. the years. Did you compare it with Amazon?
I have in the past.
But what about these Preston Sprinkle ones, for instance?
I did.
And Christian Book was cheaper?
Yep.
Nice.
By about a buck, which isn't that big a deal when you think about it. So I ordered enough that I ended up getting free shipping because I had some other things I was ordering. And frankly, full disclosure, I had a gift card from some dear friends.
Nice.
So that helps as well.
Kind of cinches the deal then.
It really did. But I mean, to that end, I think it's a good resource. Do I think it's better than Amazon for pricing? It's probably about a wash, honestly.
Yeah, I found sometimes it's cheaper, sometimes it's not.
Yeah.
So it just kind of depends on the title. Yeah.
So that would be it. I do like Crossway. I told you guys about Paul Tripp, his website and his app, really helpful as well. But Christian Book Distributors, christianbook.com, that's my resource.
There you go. If any of you guys have contacts with VidAngel or Christian Book Distributors and want to get us hooked up with some endorsements, we've already talked about them. So, I mean, only fair.
We're not in a great bargaining
position. We are non-paid endorsers of these two services.
So that means you can trust us.
Yes. We were not paid for our opinion. On the pizza as well. So,
oh, great point.
We're going to bring you the truth as we know it. All right.
Hey, all right.
So that is it for that portion. Hopefully that was helpful, insightful, entertaining.
Life-changing.
And if not, we've got more conversation and maybe we'll hit that bar in the next conversation.
Here we go.
So we'll be back in a minute on Pastors and Pizza.
Adios. We will dance. We'll be singing.
Hey, we're back.
Hi again.
We really should figure out a way to get some audio or video of the break times. That's where the best stuff really happens.
I believe more people would probably listen/watch.
They may just turn it off and be like, entirely. These guys. Yep. Yeah, I don't even know what to think about these guys. You probably do know what to think, and I don't want to know, honestly.
Okay, fair.
So we're gonna get on here in our more serious conversation, and one of the things that I think that we've dealt with is probably as long as there's been church, but really have seen a lot since COVID, is I'm a Christian. Do I really need to go to church?
Mm-hmm.
Or sometimes you hear it like, I don't need to go to church to be a Christian.
Right. Well, I even told my mom something that she told me when I was younger. Going to church doesn't make you a Christian any more than sitting in a garage makes you a car.
Yes.
And wow.
Yeah. So we're going to try and delve into that. And full disclosure, we're pastors at a local church.
If you didn't know already, right?
Right. So we'd bring some bias.
There is. I mean,
to this.
You would probably hope that I would have a bias or that John would have a bias, but we're trying to be open to this. And you might be surprised, friends, as we discuss some things, that we are more open to logic and reality than maybe some people think.
Yeah. So here's maybe a question to start us off.
All right.
So our culture is changing rapidly. Mm-hmm. Things are, we've mentioned COVID, you know, with COVID, I mean, this was happening before COVID, but it really started happening when COVID hit, is the proliferation of online church.
Right.
And resources and some of these things, right?
Including podcasts, by the way.
Yeah. So things are changing. We're becoming more technologically advanced and savvy and all that stuff. So do you believe that the traditional kind of idea or the notion of church attendance is crucial today as it was maybe in the past?
John, thanks for asking that question. Unequivocally, yes. Maybe even more so because of the disconnect that we have because of the digital and social media age. We feel like we almost connect with people because we're seeing pictures of them or videos or reading 140 characters or more, depending on how you get it. And so like, oh, we're connecting. I may know more about people, but I don't know people as well when I'm not able to see them face to face. That would bring up a lot of other things. But to answer your question, I do think that it's still crucial for Christianity. Yes, I'm going to bring up Hebrews 10:25, and I'm going to bring up the end of Acts 2 where they were together and had everything in common. We're helping one another and it's not good to forsake the fellowship. Connection, like together in each other's lives, life on life, is really critical today. As critical, if not more, than ever before. And I can talk a little bit more about that, but what about you? I'll throw that question back to you.
Yeah. So I think, I would agree with you. And I think that we, because of the kind of the evolution of technology or just the advancement, like you said, it feels like maybe it's an advantage. Mm-hmm. All these technological advancements are an advantage. I've got access to all the best preachers all over the world.
Right.
I've got access to all these, you know, I can listen, I can watch, I can have all these, I can do virtual Bible studies, I can do all of these things technologically that hasn't been the case forever. Right.
That's right.
And so There's a lot of good in that.
So much so.
Right? But I think you're right, and there's also bad in that. And I think ultimately it's going to come down, and this may be more of a concluding thought, but ultimately it's going to come down to what is your heart? Like, are you just trying to gain knowledge? Mm-hmm. Are you trying to be comfortable or convenient? And we talked about convenience Christianity last time.
Right.
Right? And so we also talked about this idea that we're the most connected, like technologically, or just the ability to contact people around the globe. We're the most connected we've ever been, but by lots of accounts, we're, I don't want to say we're the least connected, but we're, even though we have those possibilities or opportunities to connect with people, we are isolated, we're lonely, we're depressed. And so we're not genuinely, truly connected.
Which I think for me, again, whether this is a conclusion type comment or not, I don't know. I think it's repetitive in a good way. That leads me to say connecting really is, unless you are so many, you know, miles away from somebody, connecting face to face is what we are designed for. And that is how you can actually love on people. Can you send them a text, you know, talk to them on a video screen and connect with them and show them that you love them? Absolutely. But this life on life discipleship, even that really is designed to be face to face.
Yeah. So let's get one thing out of the way. Just off the bat. I mean, too late for off the bat, I guess, but yeah. Quick, early on. So, because a lot of times you'll hear arguments or discussions about, I don't have to go to church to be a Christian.
Mm-hmm.
What comes to your mind? What are your thoughts? What's your response?
I don't disagree with that.
Yeah,
that's not. I can submit to Jesus Christ. I can confess that He's the Lord. Believe in my heart that God raised Him from the dead, and be saved and be a Christ one, a Christian. But if I am going to follow Jesus, His first and most important teaching is to love Him with all that you have, and then love your neighbors, you love yourself. If I continually am isolating myself from my neighbors, I'm not obeying Him. I'm not honoring Him. If I'm not just my neighbors, but my Christian, He's like, they're going to know you're my people by your love for one another. And so He's being very, very clear. And His teaching is the Great Commission is to go make disciples of all nations, baptizing them. That's like a physical act, not a digital act, right? And teaching them what I've taught you, what I've handed off to you, bring them into the family. This is connection. And that for me is like, yeah, I can become a Christian without fellowship, without that church attendance, without being around people. And there's a whole lot we should unpack on what it means to be in fellowship and service and ministry and all that kind of stuff. And does it have to be a large corporate thing? Could it be a small gathering at home? All that, which unsurprisingly would say, yeah, you can have church at home. You can have church in a break room in some industrial park, whatever. But do you need to be in fellowship to be a Christian? Yes. Ultimately, as a Christ one, you're following Him. You come to Him, you can get saved. You're going to honor Him. You're going to want to do what He says. You're going to gather into fellowship. You're going to want to hear teaching. You want to sing together. You want to pray together. This is he said the one thing that wasn't good was being by yourself. What, are we going to go back and erase that? All right, sorry. There's my answer.
It sounds like you got some thoughts on that. So there's a lot there. That you just talked about. So
probably the course of the rest of our conversation.
So what I ultimately hear from you in that answer is that maybe we have the wrong idea of what church is and or what it's for.
Amen.
Right?
Yeah, that's good.
I mean, off the bat, you said, no, you don't have to go to church to be saved.
Right.
Right. And so I would agree with that. Right. You could be out on your own in the middle of the forest and get saved.
Amen.
Right. But that's a moment in time kind of a thing. Right. Mm-hmm. What happens after that
Amen.
Is equally as important.
That's right.
Right. And so there's a lot of pieces here, a lot of nuance,
there are a lot
of directions. But ultimately what I hear you really going after is, what is church and what is it for?
Absolutely.
And so what would you say, what is church?
Again, I'm a pastor, and so I'm going to bring you to a lot of different things, but church is the body of Christ, is the bride of Jesus, is his people. It's not a building. It's not an assembly. It's an assembly of the church, right? Where you bring them into a building or under a mango tree or whatever. But church is the body of Christ. It's Christians. It's the people that worship Jesus worldwide. Are you a member of the church that meets in Austria? You may not be in their fellowship, but you are part of the body of Christ, which includes them. 1 Corinthians 12 and Romans 12 talk about the different parts. But so that's what I would say. How about you, Pastor John? What's different for your answer on what is church?
I would definitely agree. So church, as we would commonly think about it, like, because you mentioned kind of the global church. So mm-hmm. we call that the Big C church, right? That's all Christians. Yep. United together as the church, mm-hmm. right, globally. Mm-hmm. But then you have the small C church, which is the local expression. And obviously here in our country, we've got lots of those.
We do.
Just in our little town, we've got four or five, right?
That's right.
And so the little C church would be your local body of believers that come together intentionally for fellowship, for the teaching of the word, for communion, for baptism,
absolutely,
right? For mutual edification, encouragement, right? So to me, that's where maybe some of the details matter, right? Because you can, you know, you probably, if you work at a large enough company, you've got coworkers that are Christians. You maybe have neighbors that are Christians. You maybe have family that are Christians. You maybe have friends that are Christians. And the fact that, so you and I went to lunch today, right?
Mm-hmm.
We were both Christians. We weren't having church.
Right.
Right. We were eating lunch. There's going to be some elements that are the same. Like we were fellowshipping, connecting with one another. There's mm-hmm. encouragement that's happening, right?
Edifying discussion, all yeah. that, yeah.
But it wasn't church.
Right.
So why do I specifically need church versus having some conversations with my family or my friends or my neighbors or my coworkers that are Christ-centric? What's the difference there?
Well, I think you said it. A lot of times it's the word, it's actual prayer, it's edifying, glorifying. So edifying one another, glorifying God with worship, so song and prayer and meditation and all that. It's the corporate stuff. There's a great book by Paul Tripp, and I'm only going to reference the book. We can talk more about that on another occasion, but it's Sunday Matters. You know, it's like getting together, remembering communion. Again, you and I ate food together today, but I don't remember a point where either one of us were like, Jesus died for us. His body was broken. His blood was shed. He made us whole by his brokenness. Thank you, Jesus. You do that. We do that on every Sunday. Other churches do that every, you know, 5-6 weeks, a month, once a month. And so those kind of things aren't happening when you're gathering to play Parcheesi or whatever. And that they might be, but you're intentionally focusing on Jesus, or at least you should be,
yeah,
when you gather for a Sunday gathering. It's literally called the Lord's Day in the Bible.
Right.
So I think that's my answer.
Yeah, and that's good. So the other thing, so we talked about kind of what church is. The other thing that I think maybe needs clarity, better understanding is, and we got into this a bit, but what is church for, in your opinion, that maybe is different than what we've already talked about?
Gosh, that's a good one. I keep getting to that spot of being edified and equipped, you know, and that we would sharpen one another, iron sharpening iron, glorifying the Lord with prayer and worship and speaking the word. I don't know. You know, I'm coming up empty. John, help me out. What do you think that we haven't mentioned?
Yeah. So I mean, again, I think there has been a lot of this has been within the answer of what is church. But I think one of the things that we miss when we think about church mm-hmm. is we make it about us.
Ooh, gosh.
Good right? one, it's bro. Like I want these certain things when I go to a church. And obviously, yes, you should look for certain things.
Amen.
Are they teaching the actual word of God? Are they biblically based? Are they honoring Jesus? Do they, right? There's things that you need to look for when yes. you're looking for a church.
Are my kids going to be safe?
Yeah, it's not things. Just a country club where you're just hanging out with people, right? So there are some things that you need to make sure are happening. But ultimately, church is not about me. And unfortunately, I think in our, and we've talked about this on other episodes with the convenient Christianity and some of these other things. We make things about our wants, our desires, our comfort, our idea of things.
That's right.
And again, some of that is valid. Some of that needs to happen. Mm-hmm. But ultimately, it's about the body, right? It's about, I'm going to get fed. I'm going to get encouraged. Mm-hmm. I'm going to have fellowship and connection and community with people. So I'm getting things out of it, right? But that's not all that it is, right? Because right. I am also to be encouraging others and edifying others and helping other people grow. And ultimately, obviously, it's about worshiping Jesus
mm-hmm.
and glorifying him.
That's right.
So it's not about what am I getting? It's about what am I giving to him?
That's so good. Oh, gosh. I mean, so he didn't come to be served, but to serve and to give his life as a ransom for many. So often, and we've been a part of this problem, is you make a Sunday service about what you can give everybody else.
Yeah.
You know, spiritual goods and services, so right. to speak, is right. what has been going on. But like we do this thing called Live It Out, and like Sunday morning service is over. Let your weekly service begin. We make life a lot about us. And I do think like getting up, going to church, having that intentionality to start your last day of the weekend, so to speak, yeah. out with focusing on the Lord. Well, that's a good thing. That's wonderful. And like, I just think about baptism for a second. You're baptized in the name of Jesus, the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Another way to say that word in is into. You're mm-hmm. being baptized into a family,
right.
into a body, into the bride of Christ. You are part of something bigger. And oftentimes it's like, well, I don't necessarily like the way they do this is Jesus being made much of.
Yeah. And you just mentioned a term, family, mm-hmm. right? And it's got me thinking that if you're family with somebody, like you don't have to show up for weekly dinner mm-mm. to be, you know, part mm-hmm. of the family. Like my none of my kids currently live with me. Right. So my son does not cease to be part of my family because I don't see him on a weekly basis.
Yep.
Right. So same kind of idea. It's like you're not unsaved because you didn't go to church for 3 weeks in a row.
Amen.
Right. But if he wants kind of the benefit of family, if he wants the encouragement, he wants the fellowship, he wants the connection, he wants the mm-hmm. all of those things that are part of being a family, right? He can't just never come around. Like he needs to physically come and be. And again, it's not a perfect example because obviously, you know, you're in the military or you move to Guatemala or whatever. You're not physically, you can FaceTime, you can talk, you can whatever. But there's more that happens when you're able to come over and have relationship and connection and have a meal together and all that, right? So
that's
same kind of idea.
That's really good.
And we talked about this on one of our previous podcasts. There's a small little book that was written mostly for people who are graduating, kind of this whole idea of, you know, just be true to yourself, right? And in that, he actually kind of segues from that not being a healthy perspective to when you go off to college, as a mm-hmm. you know, high school kid that graduates, you go off to college, make sure you get connected into a church, right? And he kind of equates not going to church as a Christ follower with carrying around the decapitated head of Jesus.
Oh my goodness.
Around with you, right? Because you referenced a couple of passages that talk about the body. Like, we are all part of the body. We each have different, we're different parts. You're an arm, I'm a foot, whatever the case. Right? Yep. We have different strengths. We have different gifting. We play different roles. But all together, we're the body. And so when you aren't part of that body of believers, like, you're like a little foot walking around by itself, not attached to anything. And that, let me just tell you, I'm not an anatomy expert, but that's not going to be a very effective foot. Like, it won't walk around. It'll just sit there looking so gross. Right?
It would be gross.
And so we're meant, like you said before, about for relationship. We're meant for connection. We're meant to play a part of a bigger piece.
Amen. Right? So we're gifted, it says in Ephesians 4, with these gifts to equip, to help, to strengthen. I don't think you need to go to a church just because somebody's guilt tripping you into it.
Right.
I think you need to be a part of fellowship.
Yeah.
And you need to be exercising your gifts, which happens way outside of Sunday morning, but it includes Sunday morning.
Yeah.
And so, John, maybe one of the questions that I would have for you, and maybe you've already thought through this, is if I'm in a church and I'm not feeling like I'm connected, and I've gotten past the, it's about me, nobody said hi to me, and I've tried a bunch of different things to do, and I've tried to be involved, and I've tried to participate, and I'm not feeling connected, what do I do about that? Because I know I'm supposed to be, but I'm not really feeling it. But then if I leave, am I just part of the problem? What do I do about that?
Yeah, and that's, I mean, that's nuanced. There's perspective that needs to be for any particular case. But in that scenario, if you've tried, you've genuinely tried to get connected, you've attended things, you've talked to people, you've done what you can to get connected, and it just hasn't happened, then I don't think there's necessarily anything wrong with going somewhere else and seeing if there's a way to get connected somewhere else. I would, hopefully talk to the staff, talk to the pastor, see if there's something that you're missing, see if there's connections that can be made. Because I think we're far too easy or far too quick to be like, yeah, this isn't really working, I'm out.
Right.
And a lot of times the steps aren't necessarily being taken. I don't want to call people a liar necessarily. But I think a lot of times it's, did you get into a small group? Did you go to the men's group? Did you serve? Did you, what are the things that you've done to try and get connected? And sometimes those things haven't happened. And it's just like, oh, I just don't feel it, I'm out. I would recommend against that. But if you genuinely have tried to connect, it hasn't happened. We're in a country, even in this area, which is one of the least church places of the country, we've got lots of options. And so I wouldn't begrudge anybody in that scenario to go look for a fit. Because what we have to get away from, and I think we as the church have done a bad job of this, it's not about checking the box on Sunday attendance. Like, it's not enough. Like, I walked through the doors, I sat down, I heard a message, I sang a song, I went to church.
Yep.
Right? That's good. I mean, hopefully you're getting good teaching and you're able to worship, and that there's some good in that. That's not what it's about. Like we've been talking about, it's about so much more than that. It's about community. It's about connection. It's about fellowship. It's about being part of the body.
Gosh.
And the body is about the mission of Jesus.
That's right.
Right? And that's so, so that's really what it's about. Now, I know we're running short on time here. One thing I want to hit on, because I know this is a big reason for a lot of people who don't actively attend church, and it's being hurt. They grew up in a church, they went to a church, something happened, maybe lots of things happened. Obviously, that's going to vary depending on person, right? But there was hurt involved, and they don't feel safe. They don't feel like the institution is worth their time or effort, because people are jerks. People are rude. People are hurtful.
Yeah.
What would maybe be your advice, response, reaction to someone in that kind of a scenario? There's a hurt that has happened, and they don't feel like they want to or can or both go to church anymore.
My initial response, John, is that my heart hurts because of that, and I'm sorry that you've been hurt. I don't dismiss that. I think pain can cause us to not want to do a lot of things.
Yeah.
Kathy's father, who passed away, almost 5 years ago now? Yeah. Gosh, maybe more than that. But he had a bad experience with a doctor. And he stopped going to the doctor. Now, that generation and men didn't really go to the doctor very much at all, but he had some significant things happening with his body that would have been really, really helpful had he gone to a doctor. Mm. Maybe even prolonged his life or saved his life. We don't know for sure, yeah. but maybe. And so I would say, as much pain and agony as you've had with doctors, if you've got something going on, you need to actually go to a doctor. You need to be checked if you're able to do that or ask for help with that. That kind of makes sense to people, even my father-in-law, because he eventually started going to a doctor and found out, hey, here's some stuff that you need help with. Yeah. In churches, we have a tendency to basically say that I've been hurt at church. I know God isn't the one that hurt me, but still people walk away from God because people have hurt them. But let's say they don't walk away from God, but they walk away from being around God's people. And they were designed, as you just said, to be part of the body. And so I'm heartbroken. I'm hurt over it. I pray with people. I'm sorry, you guys, if you've been hurt. I don't want you to stay hurt. I want you to be healed. And God has called you to be a part of something bigger than yourself. And there is forgiveness from Jesus. There's forgiveness to you, and it can be from you as well. And that could help you to connect. Maybe your hurt and your church hurt can help you to be very mindful of that. Try to find people that you can trust. And of course, we're offering up Crosswater, but there's a lot of amazing churches around this country, even around this town. I mean, we have a small town and we have four different churches here that you could go to besides us.
Yeah.
So that's my initial. How about you? Do you have any response to that yourself?
I mean, I would echo that. It pains me to know that people have been at church and gotten hurt. I think, and then I want to be careful how I say this, because I don't want to minimize that for anybody.
No,
I think at all. I think sometimes we put things on people or institutions that maybe feel like they were happening, but maybe weren't the way you think, right? And so I guess I would encourage you to really reflect and determine where is that hurt coming from. And I know that there's plenty of examples of it legitimately being either people from the church, the leadership at a church, the institution of the church. And so that grieves me. It saddens me, and I am sorry. I know that we have hurt people.
We have. I'm not okay with that.
We're clumsy at times. We're insensitive at times, right? And so, unfortunately, as long as you're dealing with humans, there's going to be hurt. There's going to be frustration. Mm-hmm. There's going to be pain. And so, my request, my hope, my encouragement is to try and lean in. I mean, I'm not saying go back to where you were hurt and get hurt again.
Nope.
If there's something that needs to be worked through, try to work through it as best as you can. Try Amen. To reconcile.
Amen.
Try to forgive. Have those conversations if it's safe to do so and you're able to do so, right?
Ask for help if you can.
Yeah. Maybe counseling is necessary. You know, get the help that is necessary, but don't give up.
Amen.
Right? It's God's church. That's right. I believe, you believe, that it's his design, his desire for us to be part of the body. And so lean in and know that it's people. It involves people. There's going to be pain. There's going to be frustration. There's going to be things that happen. And point those things out.
Amen.
Right? Bring them up. Amen. Don't just let them slide. I'm not saying just put it under the rug.
No, please don't.
But I don't think we can't avoid all hard things as much as we want to. And it's not an excuse to just get beat up and abused. But at the same time, I think there's a lot of really good churches out there. There's a lot of pastors that really care about their people, a lot of churchgoers that really are looking for community and wanting to encourage you. wanting to be part of your life. And so try to find that.
Amen.
And maybe it takes a while. Maybe it's hard. I know it can be.
Yep.
But lean in and trust that God's got something.
Amen. They need you and you need them. Can I say something here at the end?
Yeah.
Just really quick. One of the great resources in my life is gotquestions.org. And I looked in there, and this is, why is church attendance or going to church important? And there's a lot in there. But the last little sentence here, a couple of sentences, is Jesus is the cornerstone of the church. You can find that in 1 Peter 2:6 and a lot of other places. And we are like living stones being built into a spiritual house to be a holy priesthood, offering spiritual sacrifices acceptable to God through Christ Jesus. As the building materials of God's spiritual house, we naturally have a connection with one another, and that connection is evident every time the church goes to church.
Mm.
I love that, you guys. You're building material by God's design, and you're living. You're a living stone. You're active and important and valuable, and we need you, whether it's at Crosswater or not. We need you to be a part of that. And Jesus is the one that's the cornerstone. And so he's designed you to be like that. Get away from isolation. Get back together. Yeah. And enjoy fellowship with one another.
There's a whole lot in our world, in our culture, that divides.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, a whole lot.
Oh, my goodness. So much.
We are united. Mm. If we are submitted to Jesus, we are Christ followers, we are united by him.
That's right.
No matter what we have that's not in common, we have that in common, and that's the most important thing to have in common.
Hallelujah.
And so we're able to come together united under his lordship, under his leadership.
Amen.
as his body. And so it's important, you guys.
I love it. Amen. We encourage you. But we didn't even talk about justice and injustice and service and helping the world. We're better together, as my friend Nate Hedinga says. And so I encourage you, stay together, encourage one another as long as you have today, as long as it's called today. And that's where it says in Hebrews 10:24, like, don't forsake the fellowship of the saints.
Yeah. And even more than going to church, let's be the church.
Amen. Then you want that connection, desire for it.
Yeah. Will you pray for us, Aaron?
I would. Oh, God, I want to thank you for bringing me to tears over this topic and just watching John's face. And we know, Lord, that we are so imperfect, but we also testify that you are perfect. You gather your broken people and put them back together again and encourage us to help one another be put back together. May we not just be sensitive to your word. May we be obedient. May we not just talk about good things. May we live them out, including fellowship, being together as the church, not just going to church. God, I pray all this to you in your unmatched name, Jesus. Amen.
Amen. Well, thanks you guys for joining us on Pastors and Pizza. If you've got thoughts on any of what we talked about, if you've got ideas, we're always looking for topic ideas or suggestions or pizza locations, whatever the case may be, reach out to us, let us know, and we'll catch you next time on Pastors and Pizza.
See you around. This has been Pastors and Pizza, a production of Crosswater Community Church in Sultan, Washington.
Check us out online at crosswaterchurch.org. We meet every Sunday morning at 9 a.m. and 10:45 a.m. on the corner of 3rd and Birch in Sultan, Washington.
Thanks for listening. Be sure to leave us that 5-star review, and we hope to see you soon.
See you later.
Bye now.